مساء الخير عليكم. Hello everyone and welcome to AUC. I'm sorry we're starting late. For those of you who know our system, this is the pre-registration thing is new to us, and hopefully we won't do it again, but it's been causing a lot of delays and confusion, so I apologize once again. We will be having this conversation in English. احنا بقية الحوار هيبقى بالانجليزي, فبستأذنكم اللي محتاج سماعات يجيبها دلوقتي, غير كده يا ريت نطفي التليفونات. I am so honored to have our dear and very distinguished guest today, Anuradha Mittal. Anuradha is very accomplished yet very modest, and this was one of the most surprising yet humbling things that I've discovered about her recently. I have read about her work. I didn't know her personally. I came to know of her through her work being covered in different progressive media outlets, and sometimes even non-media outlets, non-progressive media outlets. And I reached out to her thinking that she would never respond, right? Because who would be that accomplished and would actually respond to an email from a person that they've never met? But again, talk about modesty and talk about, you know, someone who's really grounded and knows who she is and where she came from. She, in 2 days, she responded and she accepted our invitation, an invitation from APS, Alternative Policy Solutions, which she's never heard of, but she was gracious and generous enough. And of course, she's heard of AUC. My respect and almost infatuation with Anuradha, her bio is there. You can read that. So I'm not going to read that. But I'm going to tell you why I think this is worth your while. And this is something that she crossed graciously, again, crossed the ocean to be here is a privilege for me personally. The kind of work that the Auckland Institute that she founded, the kind of work they do is very different than anything that I have seen. I've seen think tanks, and I've seen activist groups and social movements. And when we founded APS at AUC, Alternative Policy Solutions, the project that me and my team run, the idea was to take the knowledge usually produced in ivory towers behind closed doors and to make this accessible to a general public and to make it to of use for progressive circles, whether they're policymakers, practitioners, or activists. And then when I met Anuradha and read about the work they do at the Auckland Institute, I saw this actually materialize in ways that we haven't been able yet to do in APS, because they produce the knowledge, but then they go out to work with communities on the ground in different places. And I was asking her the other day, but how do they know about you? So without further ado, and without me talking about her as if she's not here, we can just ask her those questions instead of telling you what she told me. Anuradha, thank you so much for being here.
But I cannot describe my joy at being here, that you have chosen to spend your evening here. So thank you. شكرا.
Thank you, Anuradha. So let me start with my first question. Tell us about land grabs. This is your, almost your passion. What are land grabs? And, you know, we're celebrating, we're commemorating, not celebrating, the anniversary of Nakba, which was the ultimate land grab, I guess. But I don't understand what is land grabbing, why does it happen in different places? So if you tell us what is that and accordingly the kind of work that you do.
Well, you know, for indigenous communities, relationship to land has been very different the way we understand it in the Western world today. Land is not just property. It is territory. It's a relationship which is based on culture. It is social. It is ecology. It is spiritual. And most of the indigenous cultures had communal rights to land, which meant use and access of land for betterment of humanity. It wasn't meant to be owned or controlled by a few. You could not possess it. However, when you look at the history of colonization, one of the biggest things that has been done is land grabs or this theft of land, because when you steal land, it is almost taking away the personhood. Because land belongs not just to the living, but it also belongs to the ancestors, to the unborn. But when you steal that land, it amounts to taking away your personhood, your dignity. It is basically denying you humanity. So whether it is 1948 Nakba, whether it is Europeans arriving in the United States, immediately the theft of the land or the colonization that my people have seen around the world, land was immediately taken because it was not just your property, it was taking away your culture, your social, your pharmacy, your medicinal herbs, your spirituality, your religion, your everything.
But when we think of land grabs and we think of colonialism, this is those images we can think of. But apparently, a lot of corporations here and now actually use land grabs. You even call it a new form of colonialism. How do communities combat that? And how's this global movement that you're part of that's resisting land grabs functioning, and what are you doing? So if you explain both.
Thank you. That's a great question, Rabab. So when we talk about colonization, we know the history of the Americas as those conquering, the settlers arriving from Europe, how they took over the land. We know the history of colonization of Africa, of Asia, of Latin America. The unfortunate reality is that what we thought of colonization then, and that was done through euphemism of civilizing the savages. People were seen as savages, and image that I can never forget of the missionaries arriving in Africa, and as my colleagues in Africa would say, when they arrived, we had land and they had Bibles, and when they left, we were left with the Bible and they had the land. So the whole idea of bringing civilization and culture to the savages, that was an essential tool of colonization. In today's world, the same is happening. The euphemism has changed. It is done in the name of investing in agriculture to improve food security. They will not say these private equity funds or corporations, which are from all over the world, rushing into places like the African continent, taking over the resources and land, not just land, but water, the whole territory. And they say they're investing to improve food security of Africa. Or you will see again, in the name of conservation, which sounds really good, right? In the name of conservation, to protect the environment, you have the same colonial powers financing schemes which are displacing the indigenous for instance, the Maasai in Tanzania, so they can conserve the land, protect the land. Now, how ridiculous is it? The Maasai have protected and they've been the stewards of the land. They were displaced from Serengeti by the colonial powers, and today the Tanzanian government, financed by the World Bank, financed by, you know, USAID, by German government, is displacing again in promoting safari tourism, hunting trips. So you displace the indigenous, you colonize the lands, you destroy and devastate the livelihoods and lives of people in no way different from what happened in the past. You said what we do about it. One of the things I will say is, just like before, communities are fighting for their land and life. We tend to think that the poor, the marginalized, are doing nothing about it. But the struggle is for land and for life. Whether it is Ethiopia, whether it is the Democratic Republic of Congo, or whether it is in South Sudan, I mean, any place where we have worked, communities are resisting these land grabs. And that's when they reach out. It's been an honor. We are contacted by communities because through word of mouth, they might have heard of our work in South Sudan. They hear about our work in Papua New Guinea or in Nicaragua. And we join those struggles. We do not go looking at newspapers where a big struggle is happening so we can drop in like Indiana Jones to help the communities. No, we don't do that. We work with the communities. If they ask us to do research, we will do reports, which will be used often in lawsuits, in national courts, or in regional mechanisms like the American Court for Human Rights or East African Court for Justice. We will take struggles that people don't know about and put it in mainstream media so the world gets to know about it. We will do advocacy. Our work recently resulted in the World Bank finally suspending financing of a very harmful project which would displace tens of thousands of pastoralists and farmers in Tanzania.
I want to spend some time on the land grabbing and be the devil's advocate, right? So you mentioned the Republic of Congo, for example, and this has been recently, a couple of years ago, as you know, there has been two narratives about what's going on in terms of land grabs, and both are equally distorting. One is that those people have to sell their land to big corporations for mining because they are poor, and that by doing this, they're basically getting rid of forests and land that we need in order to conserve, the whole planet because of climate change, right? So the people are selling. We hear this in Brazil. We hear it's always those people are not keen enough on protecting their land. And then in their defense, someone would say, yeah, but those people are so poor. That was the narrative of the government, of the Congolese government. But we're so poor and we need to sell to those corporations. So, you know, climate change is not going to help us unless you actually give us money. So are people giving up on their land because of poverty? Are they being pushed to do that or even not?
That's a brilliant question. Thank you. Yeah. Let me be clear. The fact is called a land grab or theft of land. It's not because the poor people are selling their land. It's not that for a good life, suddenly you give the land and you move somewhere far away for good life. No, that's not what's happening. In 2011, we looked at 9 different countries in Africa, north, south, east, west, some countries which had been a democracy for a while, gained independence a long time ago, countries like South Sudan that was just becoming independent. So we wanted a variety. And we looked at these so-called land deals. Because at that time, following the financial crisis, the high food price crisis, countries, especially in Africa, were being told that this could be a win-win situation. You are resource rich, but you are cash poor. So how about cash rich will give money to you and then you can give them resources? Seems like it's a good deal. So we wanted to see if these are good deals. Now, what we found is stunning. First of all, majority, we have looked at thousands of land deals all over Africa, also in other continents, but just in Africa, almost all of them have no transparency. We could get contracts that the communities have never seen who are being displaced from their land. These leases are not for 1 or 2 years. They are like for 50 years, 99 years. You find land deals where so-called investors or thieves, I should say, are saying, we are getting land which is of quality for which you would pay $16,000 per hectare. Hectare is the size of a football field. $16,000 per hectare in the Midwest. It would be much higher in UK and other places, right? But here they're paying 44 cents a hectare. You pay more for Starbucks coffee, which I hope you're not drinking, by the way, and boycotting. But 44 cents per hectare for land that these people tell their investors, look, we have such great quality of land. They say that this land is useless in Africa, it doesn't have water, but they're taking the best lands. And then they say nobody is using it. Our research showed that all of this land is being used by communities. They were forcibly displaced. In case of Tanzania, again, we exposed the largest land deal, which involved an Iowa-based agribusiness and a man called Bruce Rastetter, who's a Republican kingmaker. He got access to land paying very little money. It was a sweetheart deal by corrupting the Tanzanian prime minister. And he said nobody lives there, and our research showed that nearly 160,000 people lived on that land. And because of our work, there was a TV program based on it. In 2011, December, they were hoping to break the ground and launch their project to grow GMO corn for export to the US for ethanol. Guess what? The project never took off. So this is not, and people didn't know why they were being asked to leave. I could just go on about these stories of theft of land. You mentioned DRC. I'll just say we are involved in a case right now where King Leopold stole over 100 years ago this 100,000 hectares of land. It was then given to the Lever brothers. It was owned by Unilever, and then it has been sold to different places. And today it is owned by a private equity fund and Kuromo Capital. And the communities are still fighting after 100 years to get their land back. They face police brutality. They have been accused of stealing the palm fruit from their own land. The police has fired at them. There have been killings. So this is something which started during Leopold's time, and even today, their struggles continue for land.
It reminds me with the whole Balfour, and people taking what's not theirs and giving it to someone else. But before we go to this, your work uncovers networks of power beyond this, beyond the land grabs. There is not just, greedy corporations and, communities, but we see multinational institutions, multilateral institutions like the World Bank. We see governments in support of that directly or indirectly. I mean, you just mentioned the Republican senator. Is he a senator or congressman? So we see this. There was a very famous scandal in the U.S. recently where a congressman actually has been in cahoots with parts of the Egyptian government. So, if you can talk to us about how this works, how the land grabs that power infrastructure behind it.
Yeah, another good question. You know, I wish things were just simple. And when we get engaged, we find their networks of powers, the elites, which are behind this theft of land and who prosper from stealing of resources. So I could again take so many instances, but we tend to identify. It would be a company. So in case of DRC, for instance, right now, it is PHC, which is a palm oil company, which is operating. It is now owned by a private equity fund, and that is Kuroma Capital, which is out of the US. And then we look at who make this possible, and we find the investors who are investing in this private equity fund. And we have been shocked to find that endowments of several US universities are invested in it. The Gates Foundation is invested in it. So it becomes really important because very often, and that's what's happening across agricultural sector, across tourism companies, you have also schemes, like say in the name of carbon credits, I didn't mention, that's another way land is being stolen from communities. We believe, especially in the West, that carbon offsets can deal with a climate crisis. We don't want to change our lifestyle. And so especially corporations have stolen resources and they can do their carbon credit schemes. And we found a lot of the investors are the companies that are responsible for climate crisis or the private equity funds who are also financing fossil fuel industry, such as BlackRock, Vanguard, are also invested in this. So it's really the coming together of capitalism to fuel, to drive this imperialist, colonial, you know, this wave of colonization of resources and of people.
Anuradha, you're a big supporter of divestment, and this is something that you think about a lot, that you actually propagate. So can you explain to us, especially the a lot, you know, of university campuses in the US and sometimes even here, talk like what is how divestment and how does it work? How do you know that you know, a company is in supporting Israel, for example, or how does that work?
Well, I think as individuals, we have a lot of power. And I have been honored to see the power that communities exercise for their life and their livelihoods. It has been an honor to see the most marginalized never give up and they struggle for their freedom as the people of Palestine. I come from a country which had to fight for freedom. Freedom is never given without that struggle, as we have seen. And as individuals, we have the power, as those who are oppressed, to fight for our freedom. And I think it is a moral imperative for each one of us to join that struggle. Divestment has been a key strategy. We have seen from dismantling apartheid in South Africa that as long as we continue to invest in the systems of oppression, in those systems that shackle and colonize the other, we are complicit. We are involved. We are fueling that colonization. So I'll give you an example, starting with the work I do around land issues. In 2011, when we exposed these land grabs, we also found that US universities, their endowments were invested, for instance, in a private equity fund called Emergent Asset Management. And we found that it was involved in terrible land deals, basically stealing of land in all over sub-Saharan Africa. We found Harvard University was invested in it, Vanderbilt was invested in it. And as a result of our work, Harvard had to pull out $500 million. Vanderbilt, which did not divest from...
$500 million?
$500 million. And Vanderbilt, which did not divest from South Africa, the student body forced it to divest $30 million from Emergent Asset Management. After that, the fund went kaput. So if you want to dismantle and unshackle people and ensure their freedom, divestment is a key strategy. Right now, we know, as we speak, as we know, the horrors, and sorry, my English fails me here, the horrors against humanity that have been unleashed on the people in Gaza, in the West Bank. It is being fueled by the industrial military complex of the United States. That industrial military complex, which continues to get rich every time a child dies, every time a woman dies, every time a man dies, that industrial military complex gets rich, their stock prices go up. Boeing, Lockheed Martin, and the others. And what are the universities doing? They have endowments. They have these huge endowments. And those endowments are invested in these companies. They're invested in companies which are fueling the occupation, which are fueling the apartheid system. So the students in the United States have been very clear. They are saying, we do not want your scholarship. We do not want our education system. We do not want our fees to be used to finance and to keep the system running. And that's why it is so essential as international community to now talk about boycott, divest, and sanctions. The Palestinians have been asking for that for a really long time. It is a shame that the humanity has taken so long and continues to. And I think it is so beautiful to see the United States students who are being brutalized. Whoever thought that the students in the United States are being brutalized, they're being suspended, they're being told not, they won't be allowed to take the exams, and they're calling for the universities to divest from those companies who are responsible for this genocide that has been happening before our eyes since October 7th.
You were part of a very unique experience where actually pressure has led to unprecedented results when it comes to boycotting and what. So one of the many things that you do and that you are is that you chair the board of Ben & Jerry's. And a lot of people here might not know what Ben & Jerry's is, but this is like the signature ice cream in the US and in North America, so even in Canada. It's like supposed to be something very, you know, زي ويدر كده عندنا بس ايه على كبير قوي يعني. It's very, very, so I remember people, I think the first time I've been to the States and someone I know said, you want to have Ben & Jerry's? Because that was like big and it's expensive. And I was just like, why would I want to have, I thought that I didn't understand English properly. So having two people, I was like, have them in what capacity? In what way? I was just like, I know I don't want to have them. So yeah. So, and Ben & Jerry's have actually pulled out of the occupied territory. So it's not that, you know, I mean, in BDS we say, you know, we don't want anything that's produced in settlements, for example. They don't even sell the ice cream in Israel. So, I mean, that is quite big. And I mentioned this because this is a successful example where a lot of us who are interested in BDS, in boycott and divestment, would actually like to know how can we be successful. And let me just say, because it sometimes seems very frustrating that everything that we do, there's that big giant that we don't even see of corporations and big money and we're just going to call for boycotting and whatnot, and nothing is going to make a dent. But you managed to make a dent. How was you and your colleagues on the board?
I should clarify and say that I am here invited as a person from the Oakland Institute and working on land issues around the world. I do happen to serve on the independent board of Ben & Jerry's, as Rababi just mentioned. For those of you who don't know, it is a beautiful ice cream company. But ice cream is beautiful, right? it's a Vermont-based company, but today it is a global company available in, I think, over 30 countries. It is very unique because it is now close to half a decade old, almost 50 years old, but it was started with three-part mission. You know, very often businesses start as we will become really rich and prosper, and then we will give something back. But Ben & Jerry's was started by two individuals, Jerry and Ben, and the idea was to have a business, not because the world needed another ice cream company, there were enough ice cream businesses, but to have an ice cream business with a three-part mission, which is parallel, which is social mission, product mission, and economic mission, and the three move together. So it is like a bird, as one of my colleagues in the independent board once described it. You know, if you have a bird, say the wings are the social mission, the stomach body is economic mission, and the head is product mission. If you take one away, the bird cannot be, it cannot fly. So Ben & Jerry's has been very successful with a three-part mission. And yes, in 2021, under pressure from human rights activists, the company basically made the decision that it was against its values to continue to be in the occupied Palestinian territory. And got out of the OPT. This was in 2021. And if you visit our company pages, it'll tell you which countries we are in, but we are definitely not in the occupied Palestinian territory or,
So one of the questions that always comes to mind, and it's been big in the Egyptian counter-narrative, and counter-narrative meaning the not very supportive of the Palestinian cause, is that boycott is not sustainable, and that boycott is actually futile, and that we're never going to make a dent because those companies are so rich and they don't give a damn what happens in this part of the world. I mean, luckily, people are not buying into this. But there are people who still believe that it doesn't really matter if we boycott because, anyways, those are very rich corporations.
Well, sorry, I'm laughing because I have been told always boycotts don't work. We have the example of South Africa. BDS, boycott, divest, sanctions played a very important role in the end of the end of the apartheid. But more important, you know, I now live in the United States, where over 30 states now have anti-BDS laws. Okay? Over 30 states have laws that prevent you from boycotting or divesting or sanctioning Israel. There's no other country which has managed to influence democracy in the United States like this. You know, students have worked to get their endowments divested from fossil fuel, right? Fossil fuel companies. Even the United States Supreme Court talks about boycott as one of the key ways or important, you know, it has the highest virtue when it comes to your freedoms. Yeah, you talk about your key amendment rights. It is considered to have the highest virtue in a First Amendment rights to be able to peacefully protest. But despite that, over 30 states today stop you from having BDS. If you are a contractor, if you're a school teacher in a public school, the state can ask you to vouch that you will do not support BDS, or you cannot be a school teacher. Freedom is touted as being as American as the American pie, right? But suddenly that freedom is gone. So if BDS, boycott, divest, sanctions were not important tools, why would you have those laws? So every time they keep saying it does not work, it is the fear of what boycott can do, which can ensure freedom of people. That's why you have those laws. So it's a myth. It's the narrative that is being put forward. Oh, you can never do BDS. We are seeing the tide turn. We are seeing it. The sorry and the sad thing is, at what price? At what price? How many more people have to die? I think it's a question for each one of us. Over 35,000 Palestinians have been killed by Israeli military operations. It is a stain on humanity. We are in a public institution, educational institution. Today, all children in Gaza are out of school. 90% of the schools have been destroyed. All 12 institutions of higher learning have been destroyed. What is that? As the UN experts use the term that was coined by an Oxford don, this is scholasticide. This is the deliberate ending of education system. Why? Because education offers opportunities, freedom of thought, opens up new horizons. Everything that has been shut down by those checkpoints, by that apartheid wall, by those prisons. This is why you destroy education. Over hundreds of professors have been killed. The students who have been killed. I was in the Palestine hospital yesterday. I have no words to describe. You see these young people, the horrors that have been unleashed on their bodies, but imagine the horrors in their minds, the trauma. So for those who say boycott doesn't work, this will continue, the tide is turning. We have to join that tide because a very heavy price has been paid by Palestinians, and I can assure you, each one of us is traumatized. We don't realize. It's not just the Palestinians, it's not just the people of Gaza. We as humanity will have to deal with our trauma of what we have done to ourselves. What could happen in Gaza can happen here, can happen in India. It can happen. There is no international law. We have to do it for ourselves, for our children, and for humanity.
I still have... I still have questions, but I don't want to monopolize the conversation. So I'm going to take some questions from the floor, and then maybe if there's time, I will ask you my last question. So... هناخد بقى أسئلة من القاعة عادي بقى هنسأل السؤال بالعربي علشان كل الناس تبقى فاهمة صح ولا إيه ولا بنعمل إيه أوكي لا أنا بسأل المديرين اللي ورا هنسأل السؤال بالعربي وبعدين أنا هترجم لأنورادا وهي هترد وإنتوا تترجم لكم معاها أوكي اتفضلي
وطبعا بتصور انه الحق الشعب الفلسطيني في الحياه حقه في ان يكون عنده حكم ذاتي حق ان يكون له دوله مقابل ان يكون لاسرائيل دوله اخرى انا لا استطيع ان يعني احبس ذلك يعني حل الدولتين لا يرضيني كعربيه حل الدولتين لا يرضيني كعربيه لانه اسرائيل تحتل الارض العربيه والنكبة من 48 إلى وقتنا مزيد من النكبات، وكم من مئات الآلاف بل يمكن مئات الألوف من الشعب الفلسطيني فقد حياته أو الدم كان تكلفته عالية جدا. أنا بتصور الآن أنه في النكبة الجديدة أو ما حدث في أكتوبر 2023 أعتقد أنه التكلفة الإنسانية لفلسطين عالية جدا، لكن المكسب السياسي عالي جدا، بينما أن التكلفة السياسية لإسرائيل خسارة كبيرة. إسرائيل أثبتت للعالم كله وأثبتت أمام الشعوب الأوروبية خاصة الشعب الأمريكي والشعوب أوروبا أنه إسرائيل مجرمة ومجرمة حرب. إسرائيل مجرمة حرب. أتصور أنه يعني مع احترامي لوجودي في الجامعة الأمريكية بالقاهرة أنه أمريكا لها مصلحة أن تدعم إسرائيل، أمريكا لها مصلحة أن تدعم إسرائيل بالسلاح وتدعمها أحيانا بالدبل ستاندر، يعني أحيانا موقف تقول ما لا تفعل، أمريكا تقول ما لا تفعل وتفعل ما لا تقول. طيب هل ممكن تتصوري حضرتك أنه تتغير الأوضاع السياسية في المنطقة ويصبح للشعب العربي تصبح لأمريكا مصلحة أنها تدعم الشعب الفلسطيني حقيقة؟ هل ده وارد في تفكير حضرتك؟ وبالنسبة أنا مهتمية بدراسة حقوق إنسان ومجتمع مدني في جامعة القاهرة، أنا بتصور أنه حقوق الإنسان دي آلية يعني تدعمها أمريكا إذا كان لها مصلحة في ذلك. أتصور أنه حضرتك أكيد تواصلت مع المجتمع المدني الأوروبي، والمجتمع المدني الأوروبي ما توجهه نحو الآن نحو قضايا الفلسطينية والشعب الفلسطيني. شكرا وأسف الإطالة. شكرا دكتور ربا.
ما كانش طموحنا أنه في يوم من الأيام نوصل أنه حملة المناصرة لفلسطين ولحقوق الإنسان وقطع الانفستمنت أن تبقى كل المدن الأوروبية النهاردة بتتظاهر علشان فلسطين. ده ما كانش حتى في أقصى أحلامنا. النهاردة وكل العالم بيحتاج وبنقف ونقول انه اللي بيحصل في فلسطين إبادة وانه stop arming Israel، بس في الآخر هم فيش حاجة بتحصل. وكون يعني كون أصلا الحكومات بما فيها الأوروبية بما فيها الكونغرس الأمريكي بما فيها بعض الدول الأفريقية، فهو في الآخر أنا شايفاها ثورة اقتصادية. لأنه حتى لما ننزل تحت الأفريقيا كمية التواجد الإسرائيلي والتواجد الزاينزم أو الصهيوني اللي واخد أراضي باستثمارات بإنكيوبيشن لدول كاملة، ده بيحطنا قدام إن إحنا هنا مش بس في قضية فلسطين، لكن فلسطين هي البداية، فلسطين هي الشعلة. فإحنا كجيل ومع الأجيال اللي جاية فإيه؟ يعني أعتقد الجيل اللي قبلنا كان بيحلم أنه العالم يدرك أن في دولة اسمها إسرائيل من بعد 48. النهاردة العالم كله بيتكلم عن فلسطين. But what's next?
Hi, I hope I can ask in English, if that's okay. Yes. My Arabic isn't good enough to ask in Arabic. This is not to do with Palestine in particular, but more with the idea of indigenous communities and land grabs. You mentioned, if I'm not mistaken, sort of indigenous communities, you can attach a sort of temporal element. You know, they preceded colonialism and colonial systems and power structures. But would you say, or what's the best way of phrasing it? Can indigenous communities, that organic element, develop in a way that's, let's say, quite new, quite fresh? I think of, for example, within the context of India, Bengali refugees who are undocumented in West Bengal, and, for example, RSS and various other BJP factors trying to also take their land away from them. So would that also constitute indigenous community, even though they might not have been there before 50, 60 years?
I will try to not give very long answers, but I will stay afterwards to continue. And this is not to avoid, but just I see a lot of hands and I want to be respectful. Thank you for your question. And if I understood it correctly, I think the emperor has no new clothes. From the Balfour Declaration to today, the role of the West, the role of the United States. And it would be a mistake to not look at what has happened, the decimation of international human rights law and international law. I don't need to tell anyone here, the experts are here, and I'm sure as somebody working on international human rights, the necessity for the International Criminal Court of Justice, I mean, ICJ, it is so important for this to be followed through, because if this is allowed to continue, that means it is okay for this to continue to happen. You know, we have seen, we have, you know, Rwanda, Cambodia, but this time as humanity, we have seen a genocide being televised by people who are being killed. And if we do not do anything, and it is not just about Israel, it's holding people in power from United States to other countries that are responsible, they should be held complicit. Otherwise, our international law becomes meaningless. Lot to say about that, but I'll just emphasize that, yes, the need for accountability, the truth, and for that first acknowledgement of what has happened, as we learned from South Africa, for reconciliation, truth has to be acknowledged. And the ugly truth is the role of the Western powers, the continued colonization and oppression of people, which is based on many things, anti-Palestinian bias, Islamophobia, racism, all of those things. Sometimes I feel like you. What is happening? I see a lot of protest. I mean, it's been, what, 217 days today? Yeah? 217 days? What, like 31 weeks? How many people are dead? And we are still in the streets calling for a ceasefire? Even that has not happened. What we are talking about here, UN says it'll take 80 years to rebuild. I don't know what happens to education. I don't know about the generation that has gone through this trauma. I don't know about those wounded. I don't know what to tell you, but all I know is if I can't change the world, I just make sure the world doesn't change me. And as long as we have a breath in our bodies, we need to continue to speak out. We need to continue to speak out, otherwise they will have what they want, our silence, our complicity. We have to, as I keep hearing and watching, as the Palestinians, as the people of Gaza are saying, don't stop speaking about Gaza. Even if it feels like, what are we accomplishing? How long will this road be? We have to keep walking this path, not just for the people of Gaza, not just for the people of the West Bank, not just for Palestinians, but for us as humanity. So I'm sorry I don't have a better answer, but that's what I tell myself every day. Why are so many countries quiet, including mine? Because we have our own Kashmir. You know, the elephant in the room is, so many of our countries continue to exploit, continue to oppress, continue to other the anti-Muslim, Islamophobia, the takeover of land and livelihoods, whether it is Kashmir in my own country, to deny people their freedom. We are seeing that everywhere. And it happens in the name of development. In my own country, astounding numbers of millions of people who have been displaced in the name of development. I mean, you know, your country, Egypt, my country, India, ancient living civilizations are called developing countries, for God's sake. Developing countries. Whereas countries which have destroyed the topsoil, biodiversity through industrial agriculture, companies whose economies are now based on industrial prison complex and military complex are called developed. How can destruction be called development? And yet it happens. The right wing, the grassroots movement in the United States, to the RSS in my country, which is fueling in the name of development, in the name of religion, the so-called nationalism, the creation of ethnocratic states, a nation based on your Jewish identity, or you look at Sri Lanka, creating a Sinhalese state, ethnocratic states. I mean, I don't want to romanticize the indigenous, but we have to stop this model of so-called development is upside down and backwards. It is not development, it is destruction, where everything has been commodified, where life has been commodified, where life means nothing when you're brown and black or indigenous. And again, the struggles of this world are united, whether these are the Bengali refugees that have escaped persecution, whether it is the Rohingyas, whether it is the Kashmiris, whether it is the Palestinians, our struggles are united, and they are against this industrial, white, Zionist, Western empire. This is what this empire looks like. It comes in different forms, and it needs to be dismantled for the freedom of all people globally.
طيب هنبتدي من الاخر بقى المره دي. اتفضل حضرتك.
حجم المأساة اللي احنا شايفينه في قطاع غزة زي ما حضرتك قلت يفوق التصور والمشاعر الإنسانية، لكن واضح ان الجانب الإسرائيلي مستمر. فالحقيقة انا لدي سؤال، هل ممكن ان بنيامين نتنياهو يصل انه يقتل 2.5 مليون بني آدم؟ شكرا جزيلا.
السلام عليكم، أيمن عامر، أخبار اليوم. سؤالي يعني في البداية أحيي حلول السياسات البديلة لإقامة هذه الندوة في الجامعة الأمريكية بالقاهرة، وأحيي في سياق متصل أحيي الجامعات الأمريكية والجامعات البريطانية يعني طلابا وأساتذة لانتفاضاتهم الطلابية لنصرة غزة. في المقابل أو في النقيض، الإدارة الأمريكية يعني هي شريكة للإبادة الجماعية والحرب الإسرائيلية على قطاع غزة وإبادة الفلسطينيين. كيف ترى الأستاذة ميتال هذا يعني هذا الانحياز الأمريكي ضد الشعب الفلسطيني؟ في السياق المتصل أيضا، دائما العرب والمسلمون والإسلام بشكل عام يدعو إلى التعايش المشترك، في حين أن ما ترتكبه إسرائيل كدولة احتلال يهودية وما تسانده الحضارة الغربية ضد هذا التعايش المشترك، يعني يهدم التعايش بين الأخوة الإنسانية في عالم واحد. كيف ترى ذلك؟ شكرا.
طبعا أنا متفق كتير بكتير مع قالته الأستاذة ميتال، ولكن هو في ربط لابد ان يكون ما بين الاستعمار والعنصرية. اللي بيحصل بهذا الوقت او من خلال القرن اللي فات كله، ان اوروبا وبعديها امريكا تعاملت معانا من خلال فكرة المركزية الأوروبية، أن العالم يبدأ وينتهي بأوروبا.
هستأذنك بس في السؤال
هل يا ترى إسرائيل كدولة عنصرية مدعومة غربيا وأمريكيا هتنتهي زي ما انتهت دولة العنصرية في جنوب أفريقيا؟ شكرا.
أنا كان عندي بس سؤال، اللي هي كانت بتتكلم عن التسرب التعليمي اللي حصل للطلبة الفلسطينيين، فأنا كنت عايز أعرف يعني مثلا هل المجتمع الدولي من وجهة نظر حضرتك هيشارك وهيساعد بعد انتهاء الحرب في إن هو يأهل المؤسسات التعليمية تاني عشان خاطر تساعد في تعليم الطلبة، لأن الفترة اللي هتكون محتاجة عشان تتأهل فيها المؤسسات دي هتكون كبيرة جدا، فالتسرب التعليمي كده هيأثر على الطلبة الفلسطينيين وهيكون في فجوة كبيرة جدا بين الطلبة الفلسطينيين وبين الباقي الطلبة الموجودين في اوريدي في اي مكان تاني. بس شكرا.
I'm not sure I understood the first question from
So the first question was, do you think that Netanyahu is going to stop anytime soon because he hasn't been stopping, or is he going to go Or he's gonna just like finish all the Gazans off?
Yeah, that I got. I don't spend my time, I'm sorry, thinking about what Netanyahu will do. I do spend my time not just thinking but acting on ensuring what we as international community make him do. And and that is very essential. We do know that their war crimes have been committed and continue to be committed. We know there's a genocide happening. And each one of us right now needs to be acting in ways and doing all that we can in a personal life, whether it is showing up at a protest, whether it is forcing a workplace, or whether it is asking an academic institution to do what needs to be done. That is the only way, I believe, to control and stop those who violate human rights, and that's what the history had taught us. We cannot just expect someone to be who they are. But, you know, you look at serial killers, they did not stop. They had to be stopped. In terms of, I think we can go on about the role of the United States. I mean, there is no denying that United States is complicit, has been complicit in providing military aid, which has been used on civilians forever. A lot of people will talk about October 7th, the breaking of the ceasefire. Any scholar, any journalist, anyone who's watching knows that there was no ceasefire for the Palestinians. There has been no ceasefire for the Palestinians. Look at right now, since October 7th, what has gone on in the West Bank. Nearly 500 Palestinians have been killed, majority of them by the Israeli forces. What war is being fought in the West Bank? You look at the violence of the settlers that has escalated in the West Bank. What war against terrorism is being fought there? So we know this has happened on the watch of United States. I think it calls for many questions. We do know that the way United Nations functions is a big problem. The fact that Security Council, that freedom of people can be stopped by a country, can be vetoed. A country which claims that it cannot support the statehood of Palestine because they want countries who want peace. By that definition, United States should not be a member of the United Nations. This country has been at war nonstop. United States has been at war nonstop for endless number of years. We can say whether Democrat or Republican, they do not want peace. Therefore, it is not fit to be in the United Nations. Forget about being in the Security Council. The violence we are seeing being unleashed, and that's putting it very mildly. I mean, by that definition, my own country, India, should not be in the United Nations. By that definition, definitely Israel should not be a part of the international community. So I think we do know that we have still a very colonial system, whether it is our United Nations, whether it's international community, and as you pointed out, the roots and foundations of that are still built on colonization and its roots in racism. The occupation of the brown, black, indigenous communities is allowed because of the white supremacy. And that's what it's rooted in. It was the right to be able to go and colonize other nations to take what was not theirs that happened around the world. And that continues to happen even today. That happens even today. So I think we cannot deny that these struggles are connected. And the roots which now many are describing as the white Zionist supremacy.
Now I have two questions. But I'm going to wait. Fadi.
عندي بعض الأسئلة مختصرا يعني هل هناك حرب عقائدية تتمثل حاليا فيما تفعله كثيرا من الحكومات الغربية؟ السؤال الثاني دور الجامعات العالمية وتأثيرها على الوعي الجمعي لدى متخذ القرار؟ السؤال الثالث هل العالم سيكون بعد 7 أكتوبر له متغيرات غير مسبوقة سواء على مستوى المجتمعات أو الحكومات تجاه القضية الفلسطينية وكشف حقيقة الكيان؟ السؤال اللي بعده، متى يتوقف الدعم الأمريكي والغربي وهل انتهت العاطفة العالمية تجاه الهولوكوست؟ في سؤال تاني، التوجه الإعلامي وتأثيره على الوعي الجمعي من حيث طرق الإقناع المباشر وغير المباشر، وهل ترين أن المؤسسات التي تعمل في حقوق الإنسان سيكون له دورا مؤثرا وحاسما في الفترة القادمة؟ السؤال الأخير،
لا هو ده احنا لو جايبينك بس تسأل مش هتعمل فينا كده يعني، فاهم قصدي؟
اللي انتوا عاوزينه ما فيش،
لا مش اسئله بالكهرباء، هي لا في خلاص نكتفي بقى بال
لا هي
لا لا نكتفي لا نكتفي في زملاء وكده.
لا خلاص اوكي،
طبعا انت choose a couple of these you don't have to answer them all. في عندنا اسئله تانية؟
عايزه اسال استاذه مثال، ايه الحاجات الاكتر اللي احنا محتاجينها عشان المقاطعه تبقى ناجحه؟
وفي بقى الأستاذ ورا،
كنت عايز أعرف إيه أحسن أرجومنت نستخدمه مع الناس الأجانب مثلا القضية مش وصلة لهم قوي أو كده على السوشيال ميديا، في ناس بتحس إن في فجوة بيننا وبينهم في الكلام، فإيه أحسن طريقة إن إحنا نتكلم معهم ونوصل لهم الموضوع بشكل يفهموه يعني،
علشان تديك إجابة كويسة ما تديها مثال إيه الحاجات اللي بيبقى فيها يعني مثلا ما له علاقة بمعادلة السمية، هي دي الحاجة اللي انت
لا هم الناس إيه؟ مش واصلهم مثلا فكرة إن إسرائيل مثلا محتلة فلسطين من زمان، ومش واصلهم فكرة إن احنا بنتكلم في حقوق إنسان يعني أو في حاجة إنسانية، ف يعني هي طبعا الصور دليل كافي طبعا، بس في ناس بتحس ان في فجوه في تفكيرهم او الموضوع مش هاممهم، هو بالنسبه له طالما عايش واكل شارب هو مش ملوش دعوه بالدول دي او كده، فلازم يعني ايه الطريقه اللي نوصل لهم ان انت مش حر، انت بتتكلم ان امريكا بلد حريه وبلد فريدوم وكده، بس انت مش حر، انت في حاجات كتير مقيداك يعني، اقصد كده.
طيب الاستاذه هنا،
سؤالي احنا دورنا ايه كشعوب في الوطن العربي خاصه وشعوب في العالم ان احنا ندعم القضيه، وازاي ممكن اللي ممكن نقدمه للقضيه الفلسطينيه علشان نكون قمنا بدورنا او نكون عملنا حاجه لدعم القضيه؟ ايه الدور اللي بعد الحرب المفروض نقوم بيه؟ ازاي ممكن ترجع غزه مره تانية تقوم بشكل قوي، والمواطن الفلسطيني يكون قادر يعيش حياة كريمة في غزة اللي النهاردة منكوبة؟ ده ممكن يحصل ازاي؟ برضو عندي سؤال، إلى أي مدى أمريكا هتفضل في الدعم المستمر لإسرائيل، الدعم بدون سقف للدولة أو للكيان العنصر الإسرائيلي؟
Thank you. Yeah, I wish the Secretary Blinken was sitting here. First of all, I want to apologize if I'm not getting your questions right or haven't answered fully. There's so much that can be said, and it is enlightening to be here with each one of you, and you're very, really very thought-provoking, soul-searching questions, so thank you. So let's see, about the educational system. I mean, yeah, I think right now, of course, we are around the world, marches calling for a ceasefire, which is not even a Band-Aid. This is going to require legs of a marathon runner, that we can't just, you know, we as humanity tend to focus on a crisis, move on to another crisis. This is something which will need very sustained effort from educational system, from schools, elementary schools, to your middle schools, to your high schools, to university education. It's going to require so much of medical intervention, the psychological trauma, the distress that has been caused. It'll take, I don't know how many decades. So I think it is going to be an ongoing effort that we can't just rely on the governments and hope it'll happen. But I think as taxpayers around the world in our countries to demand where our taxpayers' money is used, I know we will be working in the United States with the students who are demanding that their endowments not be invested in weapons manufacturers and companies that are profiteering from occupation, but that the same resources are used to invest in the lives and the educational system. So ceasefire is not enough. It's not enough. So much more has to happen. Same thing, I think it's about the legitimacy and credibility of human rights system, United Nations. So much work has to happen to actually deliver justice. Otherwise, there's no way we can talk about international human rights. We can forget about that. I know the West likes to talk about civil and political rights, right? United States talks about being the champion of democracy, talks about being the champion of human rights, and we know it is nothing. It is in tatters. It has no credibility. It has no legitimacy. So we need a different international human rights system which is owned and controlled by people globally, which applies the same human rights, never mind the skin of your color or your religion. We need the same human rights. They need to be universal, never mind your sexuality, your gender, whatever. We need that same. Otherwise, we know the Western concept of human rights is a sham.
But how do we get there? Like,
how do we get there? It is going to be upon us. We have to challenge. And we have to challenge. And, you know, as an immigrant in the United States, I am deeply moved by those students across those campuses. I hope you've been watching those. This is where independence, freedom has been defined as, you know, I was saying yesterday, your freedom is your ability to choose from 10 different, your dish providers, you know, your network providers. Your freedom is defined as your choice from 10 different kinds of toothpaste. This is the Western concept of freedom. So despite that narrative, we talked about, talking about human rights has been called anti-Semitism. You know, when we have protested United States invasion of Afghanistan or Iraq, this was done by patriots who are talking about, they're not anti anything, they're pro-democracy, pro-human rights, pro-children rights. And for all those students who are in the streets, who are on the college campuses facing the police right now, they're not anti anything. They are pro-human rights, they're pro-life, not the way the narrative has been taken over in the United States, but life of children, of women who are being killed. And we have to take a lesson from those kids who are being brutalized. They refuse to go away. And we have to see this struggle as 99%, majority of us versus the 1%. Because they have the economic interest. They use the farce of religion and statehood and narratives of being anti-Semitism. They profiteer from those killings. They profiteer from that occupation. We have to look at the economics of it, which is justified by their racism, that it is okay to steal and plunder because they're superior. So we have to be untying that and bringing it down. I do believe in every place we have to speak out. I was hoping to see an encampment at the American University in Cairo.
That's a very different context, Anuradha, and I have to speak out against that. That is basically the positionality of OAUC in that global chain. And we are an American university, but we don't have, and I speak this, we're just having that conversation at the teaching. We don't have the kind of endowment or the kind of investment or how we invest things in that way. We're not, if I tell you the whole of AUC budget and endowment and everything, it's a small percentage. When you said the $50 million of Harvard being pulled out, this is, I mean,
okay.
The other thing, this is a very, the repercussions, if you call
what the students in Ivy League campuses are going through. If you call that they're being brutalized, I mean...
And I think it takes different forms. I mean, thank you for clarifying.
So,
but, you know, you answered my question. There's a teaching.
Yes.
The teachings are happening. You've invited me here. I'm sitting here expressing my views, my personal views, openly. So I think it is... You're choosing to be here this evening. So I think it takes different forms and not just listening, but then going what you're doing. You're organizing teachings, and that's happening on your campus. That education is vital, and sharing of information. You asked about what is the easy way to help people understand. One thing I'll say is we have to keep sharing. Despite being called anti-Semitic, despite being called that you are against or you want the destruction of Israel, no. Instead of responding to their lies, we have to keep telling the truth. We have to keep telling the truth. Too often we get caught in responding. I am not anti-Semitic. I am not this. No. We have to keep saying not what we are against, but what we are for. What we are for is human rights and freedom of all people. We are for Palestinian freedom because my freedom is tied to their freedom. I am asking for a ceasefire because what is happening in Gaza can happen today here. We are saying it is normalized. So we have to keep saying what we are for. We can never get tired, my brother, of saying what we are for, because what we are for is beautiful for humanity. What we are for is about life. And life is endless, and we continue. And as I once heard a beautiful spoken word from a young Palestinian woman who said about Palestinians, we teach life, sir. So we need to learn, and we need to learn life, and we need to teach life, each one of us.
I think there isn't anything more that I could ask of this event and this talk today. I still have two questions that I'm going to hold and just, you know, ask Anuradha, because this is a high note that summarizes everything, I think, that you as a person stand for. So thank you so much for being here. I think we are privileged, and I think this is a great reminder of the kind of allies we have. To your questions about how do we talk to people in the West, I think the whole West-East thing has been broken down by the kind of support that we see globally and by the kind of resistance that, you know, Anuradha, the Indian woman who lives in the U.S. but works with communities in Tanzania and Congo and Palestine, in Cairo, talking about those communities. There is a different kind of globalization, not just corporate globalization, but the globalization of the 99%, and she represents that, and you represent that. Thank you all. شكراً جزيلاً لوجودكم هنا برغم التسجيل وبرغم كل الصعوبات اللي إن شاء الله مش هتبقى موجودة بعد كده, بس استحملونا لو هتيجوا بكرة لقاء فدوى البرغوثي سجلوا. شكراً جزيلاً مرة تانية على وجودكم.